Good morning, Campbell Chapel. Happy Easter Day. Thank you for joining us for this sunrise service. We invite everyone to take this sacred time to grow just a little closer to God and to each other. Now join me in our doxology and call to worship. When they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord, our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. For a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. Because of the house of the Lord our God, I will seek thy good. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Blessed are they that dwell in thy house. Lord, I have loved thy habitation, the place where thy honor dwelleth. For the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. O sing unto the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth sing praises. The Ward Sisters now will lead us in a selection, Waymaker. Invocation by Kennedy Smalls.
Please bow your heads and close your eyes. Dear God, it's your name that is honored from generation to generation. You alone are worthy of all glory and praise, and you are not shocked by the state of the world right now. Your ways are not our ways, and you are not at a loss about what to do. Nothing is impossible for you. So today we are proclaiming that you will be glorified through this pandemic, that your name will be known and praised throughout the earth. Pierce the darkness with your light. Shine brighter than the fear of death economic ruin, or a long quarantine. When we look back on this moment in history, will we be filled with joy as we remember the revival, hope, and peace that came out of this season? Continue to draw this hurting world back to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Testament reading by Sister Kiana Marshall.
Good morning, church. I'm Kiana Marshall, and I will be reading Psalms chapter 118, verses 14 through 24. The Lord is my strength and song, and has become my salvation. The voice of rejoicing and salvation is in the tabernacles of the righteousness. The right hand of the Lord doeth valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord doeth valiantly. I shall not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord hath chastened me sore, but he hath not given me over unto death. Open to me the gate of righteousness. I will go unto them, and I will praise the Lord. This gate of the Lord, into which the righteousness shall enter. I will praise thee, for thou hast heard me, and art become my salvation. The stone which the builders refused is become the headstone of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day which the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad into it. God's words for God's people.
Our New Testament reading by Sister Kiara Parker.
Good morning, church, and happy Easter. Today I'll be reading from Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. Early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and sat on it. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell to a dead faint. Then the angel spoke to the woman. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I know you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He isn't here. He's risen from the dead, just as he said would happen. Come, see where his body was lying. And now go quickly, tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and he is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I have told you." The women ran quickly from the tomb. They were very frightened, but also filled with great joy, and they rushed to give the disciples the angel's message. And as they went, Jesus met and greeted them. And they ran to him, grasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Don't be afraid. Go tell my brothers to leave for Galilee, and they will see me there."
From all that dwells. Thank you. summary of the Decalogue. Hear what Christ our Savior saith. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. The Gloria Patri. Pastor John Black, the pastor here at Campbell Chapel AME Church, and I welcome everyone to this sunrise worship experience. I especially welcome those who are not members of Campbell Chapel. We do not take your participation for granted. We're in the middle of a very difficult season, and I realize there may be some under the sound of my voice that are struggling through this pandemic. If you have a special need, please don't hesitate to reach out to us. We believe that if we take our two small fish and our barley loaves and put them in the Master's hands, it will be sufficient to feed a multitude. Now our pastoral expressions. I encourage everyone to participate in our Bible studies and prayer services throughout the week. We have Bible study every Tuesday at 12 noon and Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. We have three prayer services on Thursdays, 9 a.m., 12 p.m., and 8 p.m. All of our Bible studies and prayer services utilize the Zoom conference call system. One final announcement, we want to make sure that everyone stays very close to their class leaders as we go through this pandemic. If your class leader hasn't called you, it's your obligation to call your class leader. Please let them know of any special needs you may have. God bless you, Campbell Chapel. It's giving time, and I ask that you place whatever gift you've prepared to present to the Lord in your right hand. If you've already given, just raise your right hand as we pray over our seed. Father, we ask that you bless this seed. Let it, dear Lord, become a great harvest in your hand. The needs in front of us are so great. The needs for personal protective gear with our healthcare workers is great. The need for food for those who have been laid off is great. The need for comfort and shelter for those who have been displaced is great. The need for unity is great. Help us, dear Lord, with this little seed to combat all the ills that are upon our land. Speak truth to power, provide low-income housing, continue to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, and we'll be careful as to give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Amen. It is now prayer and praise time. I ask that you lift up before God our national leaders, our healthcare workers, those who are experiencing this pandemic at its harshest, but most importantly, the church. Pray that the church will be the church as we go through this very trying season. It is time for prayer and praise. Thank you.
The gates and doors were barred, and all the windows fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness and rose at every sound, half in hopeless sorrow and half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. And just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle and the voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. There was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. And John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said they've moved him in the night and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away and now his body isn't there. We both ran toward the garden, then John ran on ahead. We found the stone and the empty tomb just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they wrapped him in was just an empty shell. And how or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Well, something strange had happened there, but just what, I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high, 'cause I'd seen them crucify him, then I saw him. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. And even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. Suddenly the air was filled with strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide. And I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt in my confusion disappeared in sweet release, and every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive, he's alive, he's alive, and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive, he's alive, he's alive, and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive, he's alive.
Presence of God that's in this place. We also realize that God is wherever you're sitting right now. We acknowledge our great leadership, Bishop Samuel Lawrence Green Sr., presiding prelate for the 7th Episcopal District, and Supervisor Phyllis N. Green. To the greatest presiding elder in all African Methodism, presiding elder Philip C. Anderson, and his queenly wife, Sister Sandra A. Anderson. To the best thing God ever gave me after Jesus, Sister Donna Black, and to her husband, to our ministry team, our board of stewards, our board of trustees, our class leader council, to all of our other ministry chairs, our visitors, members, and friends, we greet you in the joy of the Lord on this Resurrection Sunday. Scripture reading. We're going to be reading from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28, verses 1 through 10. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were as white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his hand and feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." Let's pray. Father, we don't need to hear today from John Black. On this Resurrection Sunday, hide him behind the cross. Let the power of the resurrection speak to him and through him, that your people may be saved. Speak to him and through him that this day will change all of our lives for the rest of our lives. In your son's name we pray, amen. Sermon title, Tomb Faith or Galilee Faith? Tomb Faith or Galilee Faith? Sometimes we fail to realize that Jesus is not the only person that was raised from the dead. My associates in my bachelor's degree are in cardiopulmonary technology. They later changed the field to cardiovascular technology. Back in the day, I was assigned as a cardiopulmonary tech to a resuscitation team. I had to carry the pager with me as I went about the hospital. And on the days that I was on duty, I would be required to stay at the hospital overnight. It was not unusual to walk into a patient's room that was non-responsive. However, after being shocked with the defibrillator and being pumped full of some really powerful drugs, some of these patients revived. The most dramatic resuscitations were those of the drug overdoses. These patients would look as if they were cold dead. Then the doctor would administer a drug called Narcan. Sometimes these patients would instantly revive. There are even times when they would wake up and begin talking. It was amazing. Just seconds before, they looked as if they were dead. Jesus raised three people from the dead: Jairus' daughter, the widow of Nain's son, and Lazarus. There are 10 people in the Bible that were raised from the dead. There are 2 people in the Bible that never died. But Jesus' resurrection is different. It is not a resuscitation. Everyone who died and later received life in the Bible other than Jesus, and in real life today, receive that new life in their old bodies. Jesus received his new life and a new body. Just as I witnessed those resuscitations in the hospital, I would find out that if a person had a cardiac arrest and suffered from heart disease before the resuscitation, they were revived in a body that still had heart disease. If a person had cancer before the resuscitation, they were revived in a body that still had cancer. If the person arrested because they were a drug addict, they were revived in a body of a drug addict. The resurrection that they received was a resuscitation, and it was a temporary resuscitation. They did not have the glorified body that Jesus had. They were all going to die again. But when Jesus died, he died once and for all, never to taste death again. Jesus was not resuscitated. Jesus was resurrected. In our text, Matthew focuses on the bodily aspect of Jesus' resurrection. He provides us with proof that there is life after death. Jesus is the prototypical human. He lived only a short period of time, but he was tempted like every human could be tempted, but without sin. Jesus was crucified, and he really died. He died. The mob, they lynched him, and he died. Now, many times we look at the Good Friday story, and we say Jesus died because the Romans nailed him to a cross, and that is true. The Romans were the executioners, but the crowd that stood before him and cried, crucify him on Good Friday, was made up of people just like you and me. Jesus did die. His heart stopped beating. He died. His lungs would not inflate. He died. All brain waves had stopped. He had a flat EEG. He died. Rigor mortis had set in. His limbs were stiff and his joints wouldn't move. Jesus died. He was dead for 3 days to prove it was not a resuscitation. He was dead. But on Sunday morning, Jesus came to life again. He was resurrected. The typical man, the prototypical man, got up out the grave with a brand new body, there to taste of death never again. And that's the signal that we too, who are very typical humans, will one day die, but also be resurrected with a new body, never to taste death again. Let's kind of go into Matthew's study, the theologian of the church, and see what Matthew is trying to tell us. He's very careful about which items of the resurrection story he will capture with his pen and how he will present them to us. In Matthew's gospel, it's the angel of the Lord that rolls back the stone. And when the angel rolls back the stone, the guards are there. And the two Marys are there, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary. The guards witnessed the empty tomb. They know that the only way you could get out of that tomb was through that door. And they knew that Jesus never walked through that door. So the guards bear witness that the tomb was empty and that Jesus was no longer there. Now, we ought to take special note of what Matthew says. Matthew doesn't roll the stone away so Jesus can walk out. Matthew rolls the stone away so we can see the empty tomb. That's a big difference. You see, Matthew is implying that Jesus was resurrected before the stone was rolled away. He even gives us a little hint. He says there was a great earthquake. And then the angel of the Lord appeared. And then the angel of the Lord rolled away the stone. I don't know, but I believe that great earthquake was when God took the power of the universe and raised up Jesus from the dead. Paul would write about this power in another place. And he would say the same power that raised Jesus from the dead also lives in our mortal bodies. Wow. Isn't that fantastic? Hallelujah. The angel doesn't seem to care much about the soldiers. He says nothing to them. But he looks at Mary and the other Mary, and he gives them a word. He says, I know why you're here. You're seeking Jesus who was crucified. He's not here. He's gone. But here's the word I have for you. Go tell his disciples to meet him in Galilee. We so frequently forget this, but these two ladies are getting ready to preach the first New Testament church age sermon. They're going to preach about the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. That is the message that has saved the souls of millions over the centuries. And the first two people to preach it were women. Now, I don't want to get political and I don't want to go into gender issues with you today, but we need to remember the story of the gospel in its entirety and not just the parts that make us feel comfortable. These women, after they get this message from the angel, are going to journey on to meet up with the disciples. And as they're walking, Jesus encounters them. And he says, look at me. And they worship him. They grab his feet and they worship him. They're putting their fingers right in the nail prints that were on his feet. And they're worshiping him. And Jesus comforts them. And Jesus tells them again the same message that the angel had given them. In the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. Go, tell my disciples to meet me in Galilee. I'll see them in Galilee. That's the context for this sermon. These women had a tomb faith, but the disciples had a Galilee faith. Here's the difference between tomb faith and Galilee faith. Jesus met the women after they left the tomb. Jesus provided them with physical evidence of the resurrection. They had a wonderful reunion and a wonderful time of fellowship with Jesus. Why was this possible? Because these women walked with Jesus all the way. They were with Jesus when it made sense. They were with Jesus when it didn't make sense. They were with Jesus when they understood exactly what Jesus was doing. They were with Jesus when it didn't seem that they had a clue about what Jesus was doing. They were with Jesus when they could logically reason through everything. And they were with Jesus when no rhythm or rhyme was in existence about what was going on. They were with Jesus when they could rely on their human understanding. And they were with Jesus when their human understanding couldn't help them. That's what made them different. They were willing to go with Jesus even to those parts of their lives that were in chaos or didn't make sense. So they followed Jesus all the way to the tomb. Many of us have some invisible line that we'll follow Jesus to that point. And if Jesus hadn't done what we wanted him to do by that point, then we take matters into our own hands. So Jesus has to bless us before we get the pink card, because if we get the pink slip or the pink card, then we're going to take matters into our own hands. He has to fix our marriage before the divorce, because if he doesn't fix it before the divorce, we're going to take matters into our own hands. He has to save our children before they get a police record, because if he doesn't save them before they get a police record, we're going to take matters into our own hands. He has to save our home before the foreclosure, because we don't trust Jesus to save our home after the foreclosure. So we take matters into our own hands. We want Jesus to heal our loved ones and take care of them before death comes. And so if death comes and Jesus hasn't done that, we just kind of take matters into our own hands. We want God to heal our land before COVID-19 becomes epidemic in Bluffton, and if Jesus doesn't do it that way, we'll just take it into our own hands. You see, that's kind of like a Galilee faith. That's why Jesus told the disciples, I'll meet you guys out in Galilee. You see, Galilee was where they first met Jesus. Galilee was their home. Galilee was where their families lived. Galilee was where they were familiar with things. Galilee moved the way they wanted life to move. They had some level of control in Galilee. Life was predictable in Galilee. Life was reasonable in Galilee. But it didn't make any sense outside of a tomb. And so they were willing to follow Jesus as long as they were in control and it made sense. But when they got to that place that didn't make sense, their faith failed. There are 3 points I want to make about tomb faith, and then we'll end our sermon. First, there are times that God calls us to be faithful in the midst of great pain. Psalm 23, yea, though I walk through the valley in the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. This COVID-19 pandemic is a very painful stop in our journey. Some of us have experienced the death of our loved ones. Other of us have concerns and worries about people who may have been diagnosed or may not have been diagnosed with this virus. Some of us have concerns about what we just don't know. Who has it? Who doesn't have it? Do we have it? Some of us have experienced financial difficulties because of this pandemic. Others have watched their stock market portfolios just retreat almost to zero. We're unable to kiss our loved ones because of this COVID-19, unable to give them a hug, concerned about getting too close or too far. Many of us have lost contact with our senior citizens who are in assisted living facilities because they're on mandatory lockdown. It's a place where it's hard to to believe, but we have to trust God at the tomb. We have to have tomb faith. There's another way to say that. God's ways are not our ways. God's thoughts are not our thoughts. And we have to trust God that when we don't understand it, he's still in complete control. We have to find peace in the mystery of God. Peace in the fact that God is bigger than us, smarter than us, stronger than us, wiser than us. And therefore, since he's in charge, we can relax. We can't take matters into our own hand. We can't control this COVID-19 virus. All we can do is trust God and rely on him and have peace in him, even when life doesn't make sense. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot God has taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regard for my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. It is well, it is well, it is well, it is well with my soul. The second reason we need a tomb's faith is that God makes sense of our tomb experiences. We often seem to have a spiritual amnesia. When we look back, we can see how God made sense of our life in the past. God wrote straight with the crooked lines of our lives. The ditch that someone dug for us, God caused that person to fall in that same ditch. God made our enemies our footstools. God made a way out of no way. But in the present time, we allow the mysteries of life to derail us. Tomb faith is a anyhow faith, and tomb faith is a somehow faith. We need to know that God is going to do what God has promised. We need to know that God is going to fix it because he promised. We need to know that God is going to do it when God sees fit and not when we see fit. We need to know that the Lord is going to make a way somehow. Like a ship that's tossed and driven, battered by an angry sea, when the storms of life are raging and the fury falls on me, I wonder what have I done to make this race so hard to run. Then I say to my soul, take courage. The Lord will make a way somehow. The Lord will make a way somehow when beneath the cross I bow. He will take away my sorrows. Let him have your burden now. When the load bears down so heavy, the weight is shown upon your brow. There is sweet relief in knowing that the Lord will make a way somehow. The third point, tomb faith prepares us for great miracles. We know the story. It took the disciples a little time to catch up with the resurrection. Two disciples walked with Jesus down the road of Emmaus for a long time before they realized they were walking with Jesus. Thomas heard all the witness of the other disciples and still didn't believe. He had to touch Jesus before he could believe that Jesus was resurrected. Peter had a head knowledge that Jesus was resurrected, but it wasn't until that fish and grits breakfast on the beach that Peter really had heart belief in the resurrection. Some of them would take them 50 days before they would embrace this resurrection. Why? Because they didn't have tomb faith. But when you have tomb faith, when you spend your time in faith when you're going through the trials, when you spend your time in faith when you're going through trouble, when you spend your time in faith when you're mourning, when you spend your time in faith when life is disappointing, when you experience these kinds of cataclysmic experiences, it opens you up for the supernatural. These experiences allow you to see the hand of God. These experiences allow you to witness the power of God. Who experiences resurrection power? Those who can trust God when they are laid off. Those who can trust God when a loved one has been diagnosed with this COVID-19 virus. Those who can trust God when the company closes. Those who can trust God when the political leaders are politicizing a pandemic. Those who can trust God when the doctor says no. Those who can trust God when a friend betrays them. Those who can trust God when they're all alone. Those who can trust God in the darkness of the night. These get to witness the resurrection of God. These get to see the stone rolled away. These get to see the empty tomb. These get to witness the presence of angels. These get to walk with Jesus along the way. They get to worship at his feet, and they get to tell the world that Jesus saves. Low in the grave he lay. Jesus, our Savior, waiting the coming day. Jesus, our Lord. Death could not keep its prey. Jesus, my Savior, he tore the bars away. Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. He arose to victory from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose. He arose. Hallelujah. Christ arose. Amen.
At this time, we're going to give you an opportunity to invite Jesus Christ into your heart to be your Lord and Savior. I can think of no better thing to do on Easter Sunday than to receive the King of Kings and Lord of Lords in our hearts. Here's a simple prayer you can just pray along with me. Dear Lord Jesus, I admit that I'm a sinner. I also admit that I cannot save myself. I realize you died on the cross to pay for my sins. Right now, I invite you in my heart to be my Lord and to be my Savior. Amen. At this time, the Williams sisters will lead us in the invitational selection. I have decided to follow Jesus. It's now time for Holy Communion. We ask you now to take out the consecrated communion which we distributed on yesterday and to get in that solemn place in your heart as we prepare to partake of the Lord's Supper. You that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbor and intend to lead a new life following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw nigh with faith. And take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees. Our general confession. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please you and the newness of life to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of your great mercy has promised the forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto you, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your holy name, evermore praising you and singing, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory be to you, O Lord Most High. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We're not worthy so much as to gather the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful souls and bodies may be made clean by his death and washed through his blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of your tender mercy did give your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute, and in his holy gospel command us, to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, most merciful Father, we most humbly beseech you, and grant that we, receiving these your creatures of bread and wine, according to your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who the same night that he was betrayed took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. At this time, we want everyone to take out their portable communion set. And now pull back the first tab or the first peel, which exposes the bread. This bread is the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which was given to you to preserve your soul and your body unto everlasting life. Take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your heart with faith and thanksgiving. You may now eat the bread. This cup is the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which was shed for you to preserve your soul and body unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. You may now drink from the cup. The Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. It's quite traditional to do Handel's Messiah on Easter Sunday. Please enjoy. Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Church Universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. To him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end.